Bismillah, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, was salatu was salam ala rasooli wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man tabi'a sunnatahu ila yawmiddin. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome again to another episode of your weekly Islamic discussion show, Guest of the Week, coming to you from Sharjah TV, Sharjah Broadcasting Authority. As always, I'm your host, Ismail Bullock, and today, inshallah, as always, we're going to cover, inshallah, beneficial and important topics. And we're going to discuss a topic that often comes up somewhat, or we talk about it from different angles, but today we want to focus wholly and completely on the meaning and the benefits that we can derive, and the importance as well, from the statement La ilaha illallah, which we all know is the statement of there is no true deity who is worthy of worship except Allah. And that is what makes us Muslims, and what makes you possibly viewers who want to, are interested in becoming Muslim, that is the statement that makes someone enter into Islam. So a very important statement. And to do that with me is no stranger to the show, Ustadh Abdulrahman Hassan. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
Jazakallah khair for coming on.
BarakAllahu for having
me. So as we mentioned, La ilaha illallah is such an important statement. It is the statement of, literally, of salvation. It is the statement of why we're even on this earth, why we were created. So we want to, I guess, start off with the meaning and I guess the importance of this statement.
Alhamdulillah rabbil alamin lahu alhamdul hasan wa thana'u aljamil wa ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah yaqulu alhaqa wa huwa yahdi as-sabil wa ashhadu anna sayyidina wa nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa tabi'in lahum bi ihsan ila yawmiddin amma ba'd. Some may think to themselves, la ilaha illallah is a word we all know. Why is it something that we should talk about? Isn't that something we passed? We've become Muslims. We are Muslims. Aren't there other more important things to talk about? I want to say that it's a reminder. La shaka, it's a reminder. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Remind, for verily the reminder benefits the believers. So those of you who know what La ilaha illallah means and have studied it in great details, then I hope this episode, inshallah ta'ala, is a reminder for you. The one who doesn't know it, then this is an opportunity for them to understand it, to appreciate what La ilaha illallah means, and to understand its virtue. As you mentioned, La ilaha illallah has virtues. And that is what I want to start with before we go into its meaning. La ilaha illallah, from its virtue, is that it's awwal wajibin, the first obligation on every one of us. And it's the last. Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he sent the noble companion Mu'adh to Yemen. And he commanded him and instructed him, and he said to him, إِنَّكَ سَتَأْتِي قَوْمًا مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ شَهَدَةُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Mu'adh, you're going to come to a people of the scripture. They have a book, they have a religion, they have a prophet. Let the first thing that you call them to be La ilaha illallah. The Prophet said, فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلَ. Let the first thing that you call them to be La ilaha illallah. And this is something that all prophets, all messengers, they started off their message with. Allah says in the Quran, إِذْ جَاءَتْهُمُ الرُّسُلُ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرْ أَخَا عَادٍ إِذْ أَنذَرَ قَوْمَهُ بِالْأَحْقَافِ وَقَدْ خَلَتِ النُّذُرُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا اللَّهَ يَا قَوْمِ اعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ مَا لَكُمْ مِنْ إِلَٰهٍ غَيْرُهُ. All prophets, they commanded and they instructed their people to testify, to bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jalla. Nabiullah Yusuf went into prison. And when he went into prison, two men asked him for an interpretation of a dream. He did not interpret the dream for them. He started with awwal wajibin, which is, he said, Ya sahibai sijni, a'arbabu mutafarriquna khayrun amillahi al-wahid al-qahar. He first of all preached to them La ilaha illallah. So La ilaha illallah, from its virtue, is that it's the first thing. And it's also the last. There's a hadith that Al-Imam Muslim narrated in his Sahih on the authority of two noble companions, Abi Sa'id al-Khudri and Abu Hurairah. Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, he's one, the six books other than Bukhari narrated it, meaning Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, An-Nasa'i, they narrated it. As for Abu Hurairah's narration, only Muslim and Ibn Majah. Hafidh ibn Hajar didn't point that out in his Kitab Bulugh al-Maram. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. This is the hadith. Remind those people who are on their last moments, remind those people who are on their last moments in this world, remind them to say La ilaha illallah. Because it's akhir wajib, it's the last thing a person needs to say. So it's the first and it's the last. ولذلك, it was mentioned in the biography of Abi Zur'at al-Razi, the great Imam. He was the student of Imam Ahmed, and he was the teacher of Imam al-Bukhari. That he said, Rahimahullah, on his last moments, his students, they came and they saw him. The students of Abi Zur'at al-Razi, they came to his gathering. He's on his last moments, he's about to die. And they wanted to remind their teacher, Abu Zur'at al-Razi, they wanted to remind him to say, La ilaha illallah. They wanted to remind him. And so what they did was, they sat down and they read the chain of narration. And then when they got to the hadith, they said, لَقِّنُوا مَوْتَاكُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. And he said it, and he died on that word. So it's the first thing a person needs to come with, and it's the last. Also, Al-Imam Malik narrated in his Muwatta, and this is the wording of Al-Imam Malik, and also Tirmidhi narrated in his Sunan, but I'm going to mention the wording of Malik in his Muwatta first, and then I'm going to mention the wording of Tirmidhi. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَفْضَلُ الدُّعَاء دُعَاءُ يَوْمْ عَرَفَةً. The best supplication is the supplication of the day of Arafah. And then the Prophet said, وَأَفْضَلُ مَا قُلْتُ أَنَا وَالنَّبِيُّونَ مِنْ قَبْلِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. That's the wording of Muwatta, and Imam Malik in his Muwatta. That the best supplication is the supplication of the day of Arafah. And the best word a person can say is لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. Tirmidhi added, وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ وَعَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. That ziyada is with Tirmidhi. So the Prophet here said, the best thing me and all of the prophets that came before me, the best thing which we said is what? أَفْضَلُ مَا قُلْتُ أَنَا وَالنَّبِيُّونَ مِنْ قَبْلِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad. This is all the virtues of La ilaha illallah. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated in his Musnad. من حديث أبي ذر الغفاري رضي الله تعالى عنه. Abi Dhar, the noble companion. He said to the Prophet, أَمِنَ الْحَسَنَاتِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Is La ilaha illallah from the hasanat? Is it from the good doings? Is it from the noble acts? The Prophet said, هِيَ أَفْضَلُ الْحَسَنَاتِ. It's not just from the righteous actions, but rather it's from the greatest of the righteous actions.
Subhanallah, you mentioned the fact that the Prophets all called firstly, and if you look even in the life of the Prophet all those years in Mecca, before the prayer is revealed, before they are told to make hijrah, he just focused all those years on calling people, even before the prayer was made obligatory, mm-hmm. on calling the people to La ilaha illallah, making sure they understood it, and Allah making sure that they understood it before other obligations came down. So we can see it's not something that you just, I know it, move on, don't talk about that anymore, like you mentioned earlier, because those were the Sahaba living with the Prophet ﷺ, but they still had to have it kind of cemented or fermented within them before they moved on to other things. Mm-hmm. So this shows the importance of it.
And what's actually more important and amazing is that they were still drinking alcohol. The prohibition of alcohol didn't come yet. You see, the killing and its rulings haven't yet come. And if somebody kills somebody, what's the consequences and regarding it? These ahkam didn't come in details yet. La ilaha illallah was what was instilled in the hearts of the companions. And that teaches us a lesson, which is, if we're trying to build a community and we want to deal with our community's social problems, the first thing that we need to start with is La ilaha illallah.
Not just that, I mean, you think about it, the more the person learns about Allah and this statement and what are the conditions of the statement, which I'm sure we'll come on to, and what are the things that negate this, so you may say it, but in reality you're not practicing it. Once someone learns this more and more and more, they will have, inshallah, more of a understanding of who Allah is, more of a love for Allah, and then these things, like you mentioned, the leaving of alcohol and these other sins will become easy for them.
For the person.
Which no doubt
is so true.
Was one of the reasons and the hikam from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala why this took the time.
It's true.
Because they were ready then.
That's so true.
They had built that iman, they'd understood what this La ilaha who Allah is. So as we know from the hadith, that they just immediately took the cups in their hand, the bottles, and poured it until the streets were flowing with alcohol. Because they had understood.
It's so true.
Sahih. And gained this love for La ilaha illallah.
I mean, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, when it came to La ilaha illallah, He referred to it as kalimatul tayyibah. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ ضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كلمة طيبة كشجرة طيبة أصلها ثابت وفرعها في السماء كلمة طيبة الربيع بن أنس he said كلمة طيبة here means لا إله إلا الله that's what it means Allah also referred to لا إله إلا الله as what he referred to it as كلمة التقوى كلمة التقوى Allah referred to it as what we might say to somebody أخي this brother he needs to gain تقوى Allah referred to it as لا إله إلا الله as كلمة التقوى Allah said in the Quran إذ جعل الذين كفروا في قلوبهم الحمية حمية الجاهلية فأنزل الله سكينته على رسوله وعلى المؤمنين وألزمهم كلمة التقوى وكانوا أحق بها وأهلها وكان الله بكل شيء عليما الله هي what did he say إذ جعل الذين في قلوبهم الحمية حمية الجاهلية فأنزل إذ جعل الذين كفروا في قلوبهم إذ جعل الذين كفروا في قلوبهم الحمية حمية الجاهلية فأنزل الله سكينته على رسوله وعلى المؤمنين وألزمهم كلمة التقوى كلمة التقوى هي what does it mean Ibn Jalil al-Tabari said it means La ilaha illallah. You know why it was called Kalimat al-Taqwa? Because taqwa comes from the root word al-wiqaya. And al-wiqaya means to prevent. It's to prevent. La ilaha illallah prevents you from the hellfire. And we're going to be touching that soon, inshallah ta'ala. Allah also referred to La ilaha illallah as what? Da'watul haq. Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lahu da'watul haq. وَالَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُونَ لَهُمْ بِشَيْءٍ إِلَّا كَبَاسِطِ كَفَّيْهِ إِلَى الْمَاءِ لِيَبْلُغَ فَاهُ وَمَا هُوَ بِبَالِغِ وَمَا دُعَاءُ الْكَافِرِينَ إِلَّا فِي الضَّلَالِ Allah also referred to it as haq. Al-haq, the truth is la ilaha illallah. The one that I just, له دعوة الحق, the ayah that I just read, sorry, before I go to the next ayah. له دعوة الحق, the scholars that said it means la ilaha illallah is Abdullah ibn Abbas, قتادة ابن دعابة السدوسي, العلي بن أبي طالب. They said دعوة الحق here means لا إله إلا الله The true da'wah So today we'll say brothers giving da'wah But he hasn't called to لا إله إلا الله What da'wah are you doing? دعوة الحق The true da'wah is لا إله إلا الله Also Allah تبارك وتعالى referred to it as حق Allah says in the ayah وَلَا يَمْلِكُ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ الشَّفَاعَةَ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said here It means what? إلا من شهد بلا إله إلا الله إلا 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 من شهد بالحق حق يميز لا إله إلا الله so look what Allah referred to it كلمة طيبة Allah referred to it as what كلمة التقوى Allah also referred to it as what دعوة الحق Allah also referred to it as what الحق and I mentioned all the ayat for that so لا إله إلا الله is everything today open the مصحف from سورة الفاتحة فاتحة is called the opening because that's where the Quran starts from Read the Mus'haf. What is the first command that you will come to? يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ عُبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ The first command in the Qur'an when you open it is to worship Allah alone. وَلِذَلِكَ ابْنَ عَبَّاسٍ he said wherever you see in the Qur'an عُبُدُوا it means a وَحِدُوا single Allah. It doesn't just mean worship Allah and then worship anything other than that. It means single Him in worship. Also, what's the first prohibition when you open the Quran that you come to? فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ Don't come with shirk. So the first command in the opening of the Quran is what? Tawheed. What is the first prohibition in the Quran? The first prohibition in the Quran is shirk.
On that point, we'll just go for a short break. Please join us after the break. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. Now, just before the break, we'd touched upon the fact, subhanAllah, that the very first command in the Quran, in the beginning, Surah Al-Baqarah, is of worshipping Allah alone. Mm-hmm. And then after that, the very first prohibition or telling us to, forbidding us to, or yeah, prohibition, is to not worship, do not create equals or partners
with Allah
with Allah
and that's it tells us a lot which is our da'wah needs to start with that command, and our da'wah and our way should start with staying away from shirk and calling people away from shirk.
It's an interesting point to mention, because obviously there may sometimes in da'wah, it may be beneficial to, I won't use the word necessarily scientific miracles, scientific facts that are there that can be convincing to people. And other issues, you may be able to bring up the fact of how there's so many social rulings in Islam that could only come from the Creator for the benefit of mankind. This can happen, but the focus, those should always be the side issues, like maybe 25% of the da'wah, for example, if need be. But the majority of the da'wah, as much as possible, should always be la ilaha illallah. You find people that don't even know that the person they're speaking to is an atheist or is interested in science, but they'll just start their da'wah straight away, focusing on how could this have come from a man? Look at this information, scientific information on the baby, etc. Could only be from God. And that's how they start their da'wah, without starting on the fact that, you know, it's so God true. Can only be one, God cannot be like a human. You know, that they start straight with all the scientific or social benefits or whatever it may be, without focusing. So we're not saying that that can never be done.
It's true.
Because you may have a person who says, I agree with you. I fully agree with Tawheed after you've given him da'wah. But I have doubt in the Quran. Or how do I know the Quran is really from God? And then maybe you can mention some of the facts that the Quran is unchanged and it has scientific facts. But the focus should be the la ilaha illallah.
Sahih. It's true. Once a person's affirmed la ilaha illallah and they agree with what la ilaha illallah means, then na'am, you can give da'wah in any other field that's important to that individual or that they may have doubts regarding. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he calls to Tawheed in many parts of the Quran. I mean, the whole entire Quran, there's thousands and thousands of places where Allah talks about Tawheed, and we won't be able to go through all of it. But for ala sabili tamthili lal hasr, just some points. Allah says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّهِ. Allah says in another ayah, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. You know, worship Allah alone. You know, Allah, He's done qada, which is, and legislated that we single Him in worship. That's the greatest rights that is upon us. If a person forsakes the rights of Allah, how will he fulfill a contract that he's written between him and his wife? Or how is he going to fulfill the contract that he wrote at his work? فَمَنْ ضَيَّعَ حَقَّ اللَّهِ, anyone who forsakes the right of Allah, فَلِمَا سُوَهُ أَضْيَعَ, and he's going to forsake everything else. The important thing that we need to understand is, what does La ilaha illallah mean? We've now understood its virtue and the good and the importance of La ilaha illallah. We now need to go into its meaning. And what's the haqiqa of La ilaha illallah? As a side point, as the scholars they say, min latif al-ilmi wa laysa min matinihi, as a side point, I want to mention that La ilaha illallah are from the letters in the Arabic language that don't have dots. There's a benefit that the scholars mention here. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, they don't have dots. And the scholars, they said, it's called huruf muhmala. Muhmala. Muhmala means it doesn't have dots. Okay? They said the reason why it was stripped from those dots is so that you can strip from your heart associated partners with Allah. Because every time that you sin, the famous hadith is, قُلْ إِذَا أَذْنَبَ عَبْدِي ذَنْبًا نُكِتَتْ فِي قَلْبِهِ نُكْتَةً سَوْدًا. Whenever you sin, a dot is placed on your heart. Those dots are sins, starting from shirk, going down to the smallest sin there is. They place on your heart dots. La ilaha illallah, it's stripped from those dots. So you can strip from your heart any sins or any associating partners with Allah Azza wa Jalla. The scholars also say that La ilaha illallah is huruf jawfiya. And when we say jawfiya, some of them are halqa and whatnot. But what we mean jawfiya is that they're not said from the lips. None of the letters of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah are said from the lips. They're all said from internally, from either your mouth and down to your stomach. And the scholars, they say the reason why is because La ilaha illallah comes from the heart. It comes from within. It's not something you just say on your lips. Scholars have also mentioned that La ilaha illallah are seven words. La ilaha illa Allah Muhammad Rasul Rasulul La ilaha illa Allah. La ilaha illa Allah. Muhammad Rasul Allah. Seven. These seven, the scholars, they say they protect you from the seven doors of the hellfire. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, لَهَا سَبْعَةُ أَبْوَابٍ لِكُلِّ بَابٍ مِّنْهُمْ جُزْءٌ مَقْصُومٌ. Before that Allah says, وَإِنَّ جَهَنَّمَ لَمَوْعِدُهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. لَهَا سَبْعَةُ أَبْوَابٍ لِكُلِّ بَابٍ مِّنْهُمْ جُزْءٌ مَقْصُومٌ. The hellfire has seven doors. Say these seven from your heart deep down, it will protect you from the hellfire. So that's a side benefit that we need to understand. And La ilaha illallah are from the letters that are not hard to pronounce. They are not like Kha, which some people may not be able to say. Or Dad, which is a hard word to pronounce. It's none of those letters. It's Huruf, which are Sahla. The reason is because when the person comes into Islam, he is easy, and it's easy for them to pronounce. And even when you're doing your dhikr, which your mouth should be doing a lot, it's easy to say. It's not something that is, it's not hard. It's not a hard letter to pronounce. Now we want to go into what La ilaha illallah means. The meaning of La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah, as you can see, it starts with the word La. And the word La in the Arabic language is nafi, it's a negation. And according to the Arabs, La al-nafiyah fi kalam al-arabi, according to the Arabic language, naw'an, is two types. The La of negation in the Arabic language is two types. So I'm going to try to simplify it because it's very important that we understand this point, which is the first type of La is what they call La التي تعمل عمل إن التي تعمل عمل ليس. There's a La that does the same, or it plays the same role as ليس. That La and ليس are the same. What does ليس do? According to the grammarians, ليس, what it does is ترفع الاسم وتنصب الخبر. So what you say is لا رجل قائما. لا رجل قائما. It was before رجل قائم, but now you say لا رجل قائما. Just the way you say ليس رجل قائما, you say لا رجل قائما. It's the same as ليس. This type of لا النافية that does the same and plays the same role as ليس, the scholars they say it تنفي الوحدة وتحتمل العموم. What does that mean? That la that resembles and plays the same role as laysa, it only negates one. So look at the word la rajulun qa'iman. When you say that, what it means is not one man is standing. So there's a possibility that two is standing, or three is standing, or four is standing, or five, or many more are standing. All you've negated is what? Tanfil wahda. You've only negated one, and there's a possibility that the others are negated, but it's a possibility. The second type of negation, it's called التي تعمل عمل إن. It plays a role of إن. What does إلا إن do? إن does the total opposite of ليس, which is تنصب الاسم وترفع الخبر. So you say إن, you say إن رجلا قائم. إن رجلا قائم. إن plays what? إن is the opposite of ليس. The second type of لا, which resembles inna. It doesn't resemble laysa, it resembles inna. Which is what you say is la rajula qa'imun. This type of la, the scholars they call it nafyul jinsi. It's the strongest type of la. It doesn't negate one only, but it also negates two and three and four and five and six and seven and eight and nine and ten and a thousand. It negates all. So when you say la rajula qa'imun, you mean there's no man standing. Khalas. Not one is standing, or two is standing, or three, or four. Nothing is standing.
Whatsoever.
Whatsoever. It's the strongest type of negation. And that's the type that is used in what? In kalimat al-tawheed. La ilaha illallah. Here's the question. When do we know to use it for the first type or the second type? When do we place it under the category of التي تعمل عمل ليس? Or when do we place it in التي تعمل عمل إن? When do we do it? The scholars, they say there are seven conditions, but we're not going to mention those conditions because they're not what concerns us now. But Ibn Malik, he said in his Alfiyah, عَمَلَ إِنَّ عَمَلَ إِنْ نَجْعَلْ لِلَّهِ فِي النَّكِرَ مُفْرَدَةً جَاءَتْكَ أَوْ مُكَرَّرَ. That it has to be indefinite. And I really want this point to be understood very well, which is the one that plays the role of the second type of nafi. The scholars, they say that the isim and the khabar, both of them have to be indefinite. They both have to be indefinite. For example, when we say la ilaha, ilaha is indefinite. Ilaha is what? Indefinite. Just like what we said, la rajula qa'imun. Rajul here is indefinite, and qa'imun is indefinite as well. Because there's in there qa'imun, in there is a nunu, tanwilu tankir. It's indefinite. No man is standing. If they both become indefinite, they show generalization. It negates everything. It falls under the second category. But if it doesn't, then they take it out. Here the question is, La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. They're both not indefinite because we have La ilaha and then we have illallah. Illallah. Allah is not indefinite. See, but what did he call Allah? He called it A'raful al-ma'arif. You can't say Allah is indefinite. So how is it possible that we'd added under the second category, which is التي تعمل عمل إن. So the scholars, they said the way to overcome that is by placing a word called حق. We say there's none worthy of worship. أما حق, we bring that word حق in the sentence and we make that the خبر of لا. And where did we bring that word حق from? It's the statement of Allah, ذلك بأن الله هو الحق وأن ما يدعون من دونه هو الباطل. That's a technical side of looking at it. But now let's go into an easier understanding of it, because I really felt that it was important that the people understand that la that's in here and how strong it is in the Arabic language. And that it means that there we do not believe as Muslims there is anyone out there worthy of worship except Allah Azza wa Jalla.
So this has showed us that this is a very firm, no doubt about it whatsoever. It's just 100% clear that there is nobody.
It's true. And once a person has said that, and a person has come with that, they should realize the weight of what they've just said. So it's not possible that after that you worship other than Allah, or you call unto someone, or you supplicate to someone, or you place an oath unto someone other than Allah Azza wa Jalla. Because you've just said La ilaha illallah. You've negated everything and everyone and anyone, and you've only affirmed it for Allah. ولذلك, the scholars, they say the pillars of La ilaha illallah is a nafyun wa ithbat, negation and affirmation. Negating it from everything else and only affirming it for Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's the two pillars in which La ilaha illallah stands on. La ilaha illallah, what is it that you're negating from everyone else? You're negating from everything else, ibadah. And the scholars, they say, when we look at ibadah, we need to look at it from two angles. Al-muta'abbad wal-muta'abbadu bihi. The ibadah, so what is ibadah? What can we call ibadah? Ibn Taymiyyah summarized it, he called it ismun jami'un li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah wa yardah min al-aqwali wal-a'mali al-zahirati wal-batinah. It's a general term. Ismun jami'un li kulli ma yuhibbuhu Allah. That which Allah loves and is pleased with. Min al-aqwali, its speech, wal-a'mali and its actions, al-zahirati wal-batinah. External actions and internal actions. External actions are salah and internal actions are at-tawakkul wal-raghba wal-rahba and others.
Just hold you on that point, inshallah. Join us, inshallah, after this break. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back. Now, we in this last part of the show, we want to, I guess, cover the conditions of La ilaha illallah. Because like we said, it's not just a simple statement that you give word of mouth and you quickly move on and that's enough. There are things that kind of, like anything, kind of show the reality of your real belief or your real practice of La ilaha illallah. So in this last 14 minutes or so of the show, we're going to focus on those seven, what the scholars have said, seven conditions.
Just before I mention that, I just want to go recap on one point that I was just about to say, which was, that the ibadah is looked at from two angles. The first one is, what is a ibadah and what can we call a ibadah? And I've already mentioned that. Now the question is, how do I then now do that ibadah? How do I come with that ibadah? The scholars, they say you do it with complete love and complete humility. Like you prostrate to Allah with complete love and complete humility. Ibn al-Qayyim says, وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَنِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ وَخُضُوعِ قَاصِدِهِ هُمَا قُطْبَانِ. The two things that you need to come with every ibadah that you're doing is complete love and complete humility. If something is not an ibadah, but you do it in those two ways, the scholars, they said that you've associated partners with Allah. Because somebody may force you to prostrate to them, but that doesn't necessarily mean that you're doing it with complete love. You've humiliated me, but then this person hasn't gained love from me in doing this for them. The only one that you humiliate yourself for them, and you put yourself low by putting your face on the ground for him, is Allah Azza wa Jalla. And while you're doing that, you're in complete love with him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now coming back to your question, which is the conditions of La ilaha illallah. Scholars, they call it shurutu La ilaha illallah. And in the Arabic language, shart is ma yalzamu min wujudihi alwujud wa la yalzamu min adami aladam. It's a prerequisite. It's needed before you come with La ilaha illallah. These seven have to be there.
Before we just go into that, I'd like to mention to some of the viewers, because we get this a lot of the time, even when we've spoken in the past about the three categories of Tawheed, you do have some people out there who don't understand. And you unfortunately have people who say to people, those people, they're making up these labels. Where was the three categories of Tawheed in the time of the Prophet? Where was the seven conditions of La ilaha illallah? But we'd like to address, apart from the fact we're going to mention evidences behind that, and nearly all these categories that the scholars have done, they're based upon Quranic verses. Like you'll find in Surah Al-Fatiha alone, sometimes even in one ayah alone, you'll find evidences for the three categories of Tawheed. But you'll find that the same people who put those doubts, they don't say anything about many scholars who for a long time have done the conditions of wudu. And we know there's conditions of wudu. You must do A, B, C, D for your wudu to be valid. If you do E, F, G, H, your wudu is invalid. So likewise, how the scholars categorized to make people understand that if these things are present, your wudu is accepted.
It's so true.
And if these things happen, your wudu is not accepted.
It's true.
It's exactly all taken from ayat and hadith. Likewise, is it the same when it comes to these seven conditions?
It's true. And there's one ayah that concludes or brings all the three types of tawheed is in Surah Maryam, ayah 66 or 67, I think. Allah says, رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا رُبُوبِيَةً فَعَبُودُهُ وَاصْطَبِرْ لِعِبَادَتِهِ أُلُوهِيَا هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِّيًا الْأَسْمَاءُ وَصِفَاتِ. So it's in the Quran like that. It's in Surah Al-Fatiha. Ibn Jalil al-Tabari, when it comes to Surah Al-Fatiha, he mentions it there, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Also, Shaykh Abdul Razak al-Badr, he wrote a kitab on this. He called it Al-Qawlu al-Sadid fi Munkiri Taqseem al-Tawheed. He talks about the category. And he mentions Ibn Abu Hanifa is the one who said it. Ibn Battah mentioned it. He brings the kalam of the Salaf who said that the Tawheed is of those types. Coming back to the shurut of La ilaha illallah, as I said, that the shurut is a prerequisite. You need to come with it prior and before La ilaha illallah. And Hafidh al-Hakami, he summarized the seven in two lines of poetry. He says, Al-ilmu wal-yaqeen wal-qabulu wal-inqiyadu fadri ma aqulu wal-sidqu wal-ikhlasu wal-mahabbah waffaqaka Allahu lima ahabbah. Those are the seven. So the first one is Al-ilmu. Ilm, what does it mean? It means idraku shay ala ma huwa alayhi idrakan jaziman. It's to perceive something as it is with certainty. That's what ilm means. The evidence for coming with ilm for la ilaha illallah is many. For example, is an ayah that I mentioned before, وَلَا يَمْلِكُ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِهِ شَفَاعَةَ إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. إِلَّا مَنْ شَهِدَ بِالْحَقِّ. Anyone who comes with la ilaha illallah, وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ أَيْ وَيَعْلَمُونَ حَقِيقَةَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That they know the real meaning of la ilaha illallah. Also Allah تبارك وتعالى he said فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لِذَنْبِكَ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ. Even though the Prophet is being spoken to here, فَعْلَمْ know Muhammad, but the principle according to the scholars is, as صاحب البراقي mentions in his lines of poetry, وَمَا بِهِ قَدْ خُوطِبَ النَّبِيُّ. Anything that the Prophet was being spoken to, تَعْمِيمُهُ فِي الْمَذْهَبِ السَّنِي. وَمَا بِهِ قَدْ خُوطِبَ النَّبِيُّ تَعْمِيمُهُ فِي الْمَذْهَبِ السَّنِي. Even that the Prophet was spoken to here, it's for everybody. It's like, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu taqillah. So, fa'alam, Muhammad, have knowledge of La ilaha illallah. That's for him and everyone else. It's for everybody else. That's the first type of tawheed. The second type is al-yaqeen. First condition of La ilaha illallah. The second condition of La ilaha illallah is al-yaqeen, certainty that the person in he or she's heart, they are certain about what La ilaha illallah means.
They know that they are certain, that they believe the statement, and they are certain
about
that
it.
There can only be
Naam.
No one deserves worship except Allah.
Except Allah, tabarak wa ta'ala. Allah said in Surah Al-Hujurat, He says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أُولَٰئِكَ الصَّادِقُونَ. Allah says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The believers are nothing, because the word إِنَّمَا is مِنْ أَلَوَاكِ الْحَصْرِ. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. The believers are nothing except those who believe in Allah and His Messenger. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا means they don't have no doubt in their hearts. You see, the scholars, they said something very powerful here, is that Allah used ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. They didn't come with doubts. Allah didn't say وَلَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. But when it came to وَجَاهَدُوا بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, Allah said وَجَاهَدُوا. He used the waw. The scholars, they said the reason why ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا was used here is because as soon as they believed in Allah and His Messenger, they didn't come with doubts. The certainty was with the belief of Allah and His Messenger. But as for fighting and whatnot and jihad, it came later. It came later into Islam. Also the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith, Al-Imam Abu Hurairah narrated that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. It's found in Bukhari and in hadithi Abu Hurairah. The Prophet said, أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَأَنِّي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ لَا يَلْقَى اللَّهُ بِهِمَا عَبْدٌ لَا يَلْقَى اللَّهَ بِهِمَا عَبْدٌ غَيْرُ شَاكٍ فِيهِمَا إِلَّا أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ الْجَنَّةِ. Nobody says la ilaha illallah Muhammad al-Rasulullah with certainty.
That reminds me of the other hadith. The Prophet said, من قال لا إله إلا الله مخلصا من قلبي دخل الجنة. So he said again, whoever says la ilaha illallah sincerely, and obviously that's another condition, but it's kind of connected as well to yaqeen, isn't it? There has to be the certainty and the sincerity that he will enter paradise. So that's the second condition.
That's the second condition. The third condition is العلم واليقين والقبول. قبول, acceptance. To accept this in wholeheartedly. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said about the disbelievers, إِنَّهُمْ إِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَسْتَكْبِرُونَ وَيَقُولُونَ أَإِنَّا لَتَارِكُوا آلِهَتِنَا لِشَاعِرٍ مَجْنُونَ. They don't want to believe. أُحْشُرُوا الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَزْوَاجَهُمْ وَمَا كَانُوا يَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَهَدُوهُمْ إِلَى صِرَاطِ الْجَحِيمِ وَقِفُوهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ مَسْئُولُونَ. They don't want to believe. They're arrogant, they're stubborn, they're hard-headed. When the Prophet said, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ تُفْلِحُ. Say, لَا إِلَهَ اللَّهُ, you're going to find success. What did they say? أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا أَجَعَلَ الْآلِهَةَ إِلَهًا وَاحِدًا إِنَّ هَذَا لَشَيْءُ الْعُجَابِ. Has he made it into one ilah that we need to worship Muhammad? So they didn't accept it. They became stubborn and hard-headed. But the believer accepts. The next one is, it's الصدق, to believe in it. So it's al-ilm wal-yaqeen wal-qabool wal-inqiyad. Inqiyad. Inqiyad means submission. That the person submits. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He said in the ayah, وَمَنْ يُسْلِمْ وَجْهَهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنْ فَقَدْ إِسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى فَقَدْ إِسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى وَإِلَى اللَّهِ عَاقِبَةُ الْأُمُورِ. وَمَنْ يُسْلِمْ وَجْهَهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. The person submits to Allah Azza wa Jalla. The Prophet عليه السلام said, لَا يُؤْمِنُ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يَكُونَ هَوَاهُ تَبَعًا لِمَا جِئْتُ بِهِ. The hadith is, scholars have questioned its authenticity, but the point is that a person is not a true believer until his desires is in line with what I came with. وَمَنْ يُسْلِمْ وَجْهَهُ. Anyone who submits himself to Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's inqiyad, and that's the evidence for it. And then we have the next one, which is الصدق, to believe. Allah says, أَلِفْ لَا مِّمْ أَحَسِبَ النَّاسُ أَنْ يُتْرَكُوا أَنْ يَقُولُوا آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ وَلَقَدْ فَتَنَّا الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ فَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَلَيَعْلَمَنَّ الْكَاذِبِينَ. To believe. The munafiqeen are the ones who don't believe. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ بَيَقُولُوا آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَمَا يَخْدَعُونَ إِلَّا أَنفُسَهُمْ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ فَزَادَهُمُ اللَّهُ مَرَضًا وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْذِبُونَ. They don't believe. They came with the opposite of الصدق. The next one is الصدق والانقياد والصدق الإخلاص. Sincerity. And you mentioned the evidence for that. أَلَا لِلَّهِ الدِّينُ الْخَالِصًا قُلِدُعُ الَّذِينَ قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ أَنَا أَوَّلُ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. This ayah. أما قُلِ اللَّهَ أَدْعُو قُلِ اللَّهَ أَدْعُو
Even the Surah Al-Bayn
وَمَا أُمِرُ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ دِينِ. There are many evidences for it. أما قُلِ اللَّهَ أَعْبُدُ مُخْلِصًا لَهُ دِينِ. And the hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أَسْعَدُ النَّاسِ بِشَفَاعَتِي يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ مُخْلِصًا أَمَا خَالِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ أَوْ مِنْ نَفْسِهِ. The last one, which is al-mahabba, that the person loves la ilaha illallah. They really love it. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من ولده ووالده والناس أجمعين. And Allah says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا إِلَى آخِرِ الْآيَةِ. Mahabba, you love la ilaha illallah deep in your heart. You know, and it's something you truly settled in your heart. Those are the seven conditions.
And obviously, we can't go into them now, but obviously, just like you have those seven conditions, for example, if you have sincerity, the opposite, which would show that you're falling short, would be that if you feel you're not really sincere in your statement, or if you're having certainty, but on the other side, you're not really certain. So everything you has the opposite. So if you feel, the person feels that he's not having full certainty, then he knows he has to work on this, he's la ilaha illallah, is falling short. Mm-hmm. If he knows that he's not 100% sure, like you mentioned, that whoever believes me, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in my message, without any doubt. So all of these conditions, just as there is truth, believing it truthfully, if there is if there is lacking in this truthfulness, or this sincerity, or this following or submission, all of these things, if there is some lacking in there or some doubt, then the person knows that he has to work on his la ilaha illallah and he has to go back to it.
Yeah, each and every one of them have opposites that the person needs to stay away from. Like ilm, the opposite of it is ignorance and whatnot. That the person should work against it. And as you mentioned at the beginning of the episode, is that وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Your existence in this world is based on this. La ilaha illallah. This is why you're here in this world. You're not here to make money. You're not here to eat. You're not here to sleep. All of those should serve la ilaha illallah. That doesn't mean you don't work. That doesn't mean you don't sleep. That doesn't mean you don't eat. But it means is that all of these things are meant to aid and support you in coming with la ilaha illallah, worshipping Allah Azza wa Jalla.
I mean, we've only got like a minute or so left, but just you mentioned that. You mentioned work, etc. All of those things that you're doing, if you're doing it with the intention to please Allah in a halal way, you're rewarded for your money, you're rewarded for your food, you're rewarded for feeding your wife and family, or anything you basically do, as long as it's not forbidden, if you do it to please Allah and to be in line with this la ilaha illallah, which ultimately as well means obeying Allah, submitting to Him, doing your best to live by His commands,
that's true,
then you will be rewarded. And we pretty much come to the end of today's episode. May Allah reward you for coming on, inshallah, until we have you next time. And also for the viewers, we hope that you've had an understanding of the importance of the statement, its meanings, its benefits, and why we should learn and continue to learn and refresh whatever we've learned on this kind of topic about la ilaha illallah and who Allah is. And until next time, inshallah, I leave you as always. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.